Atrial fibrillation is the most common heart rhythm abnormality, and it results in the upper chamber of your heart beating extremely fast, 500, 600 beats a minute. This causes an irregular, rapid heartbeat. It's very much of an age-related problem. It's rare before 50. By the time you're 80, 1 in 10 people have AFib. It's also more common if you have other types of heart disease, if you're very obese. Sometimes it runs in families. So it's a very common, important problem affecting about over 5 million adults in the United States. Diagnosis of atrial fibrillation is by obtaining an EKG, which will document atrial fibrillation. And so this is something that your internal medicine doctor may do, maybe picked up incidentally when you're getting a routine checkup, or you may have symptoms. Your heart may be racing, you may feel fatigued, know that something's not right, an EKG is obtained, and you're told you have atrial fibrillation. The first thing we think about with atrial fibrillation is stroke risk, because one of the most devastating complications of atrial fibrillation is having a stroke, which can change your life forever or even kill you. So that's the most important management question. Different patients have different risks of stroke. Some have high risk of stroke, some have low risk of stroke. But if you have atrial fibrillation, your stroke risk on average is fivefold increased. So there's a number of different treatments we can do to lower that risk of stroke, and that's the most important treatment strategy. We also think about medications to control the atrial fibrillation or procedures to cauterize the atrial fibrillation, and there's other medications just to slow it down. So it's a conversation that you'll have to have with your physician if you're diagnosed with this condition. Atrial fibrillation on average increases your stroke risk fivefold. But some patients are at very high risk of stroke, maybe 10% per year. In other patients, the risk of stroke is extremely low despite having atrial fibrillation. The risk factors we think about are age over 65, diabetes, hypertension, a prior stroke or TIA, coronary disease. Those are the things that we use to decide, is a patient high risk or is a patient low risk or are they somewhere in between? If a patient has atrial fibrillation and they have enough risk factors where their stroke risk is, we'll say, 2% per year or higher, then we want to do something to lower that risk. We can either use anticoagulants like Coumadin, warfarin, the old drug that's been around for 40 years. There's also newer anticoagulants where you don't have to monitor your blood levels and you don't have to adjust how much salad you have and so forth. We call those NOACs, these new oral anticoagulation medications. And then more recently, there's been techniques developed to lower stroke risk without having to take a medication, and this is called appendage occlusion. So of patients who have AFib who are at high stroke risk and should be on a blood thinner, only about 50% are because they have bleeding problems. They may have nose bleeding or GI bleeding, or they may be at risk of falls where they can't be on a blood thinner. And for these patients, the good news is there's a new approach to lowering stroke risk called occlusion of the left atrial appendage. Now, this is a heart I brought with me, and it shows the left atrial appendage, which is a little sock-like windsock that comes off the left atrium. That's where the clots form that cause strokes in patients with atrial fibrillation. So there's a number of techniques to either put a plug in this little windsock from the inside or go from the outside under the sternum, the chest bone, and tie it off, or go in surgically and put a little clip on that structure. And that is as effective as blood thinners at lower stroke risk. So it's an important new alternative that we have for all these patients that can't take blood thinners. So as we said, this appendage is where the strokes form. So there's a number of different techniques to get rid of that appendage. Either you can go in with a minimally invasive surgical technique through your chest wall and put a little Barbie pin-like device on it and clamp it down and get rid of it that way. Or you can go in with a snare under the chest bone in a cath lab setting and tie it off, cinch it off using a percutaneous technique that does not involve surgery. Or the third way is to put a plug in from the inside of the heart, where we go up from the leg, thread this plug into the chamber, and then we just deploy it like an umbrella, and that occludes the appendage and lowers the stroke risk back to a more normal level. So deciding which of these approaches is right for a given patient is a major decision. And it involves assessing a patient's anatomy, what does this structure look like? And we have a team at Hopkins of imaging cardiologists, cardiac surgeons, and cardiologists, and we meet together to decide the right approach for the right patient. If someone's had prior chest surgery, then they aren't a candidate for the technique where we'd go in through the chest or under the sternum bone. And for them, we would use the plug approach through the leg. If someone can't be on a blood thinner, then we would use one of the other techniques where we go in through the chest, where you don't have to be on a blood thinner for the first 6 weeks, which is the case with the umbrella-like device we deploy from the inside. So I think the important message is, it's a big question which of these devices is the right device for a given patient, and that's where we have this team that will review your case and make a formal recommendation.